Hello, cousins. This is your cousin Breezy here with something really special. It's the personal scrapbook of one of the first ladies of rock and roll, Connie Francis. You know, cousins, every time I hear a classic hit, it takes me to a different place at a different time. Through our video scrapbook, cousins, Connie will take us to a simpler and sweeter world, but one charged with excitement. It's a world in which a handful of performers, composers, and producers were making music history. Connie, take us back.
One of the most beautiful songs ever written about our country is The House I Live In. Its inspiring lyrics say it all. I was saddened to learn recently that the composer of this song, Earl Robinson, had passed on. But he's left behind this very special song, whose meaningful lyrics will surely live in the hearts of Americans for all time.
Who's Sorry Now was Connie Francis' first big hit. It was the song that made her a star, and it was a song she almost let slip through her fingers.
One day, MGM called my manager and told him I should look for a day job. Who could blame them? My first 9 records were bombs. That added up to 18 songs that went nowhere. I had one more session left on my contract, one more shot at making it. As usual, my father was convinced he had the answer. As usual, I thought otherwise. Daddy and I communicated in only one way, Italian style. We argued and fought about everything, especially music, which was his whole life. After listening to the demos of the songs I'd chosen for my swan song session, he shook his head in utter disgust.
That is until New Year's Day, 1958. It was a festive holiday in Connie's New Jersey home, which was packed with relatives and good conversation. But Connie didn't let the party interrupt her routine. At 4 o'clock, just like 8.5 million American teenagers, she dashed over to the family black and white Motorola, clicked it on, and there was the institution they called American Bandstand. And there making it all happen was her idol, Dick Clark. Connie was only half paying attention when Dick mentioned something about a new girl singer. Then she really got an earful. The opening bars of Who's Sorry Now were coming from the television.
Sorry now.
With Connie screaming, Dick Clark is playing my song, the living room was quickly packed with more than 30 family members. They all strained to hear the national debut of Connie's soon-to-be hit from the TV's 4-inch speaker. Things would never be the same again. From that moment on, Connie Francis would be able to pinpoint the precise moment that Dick Clark transformed her teenage existence into the life of a major recording star. Well, that's how it all began, cousins. Connie was well on her way to the top. She earned a gold record for Who's Sorry Now almost immediately. But soon, she was having a rough time coming up with a follow-up hit. And then one day, a struggling song publisher friend named Don Kirshner brought two teenage songwriters to her house.
One of them was lanky Howie Greenfield, who was an errand boy or a gopher at a music publishing firm. His partner had more impressive credentials. He was a Juilliard student named Neil Sedaka. For 97 hours, they played me every slow ballad they ever wrote. Until finally I got so bored, I plopped myself down on the couch and began writing in my diary. But they still didn't get the hint. Neil continued to play songs merrily into the next century. Finally, I said sympathetically, "Look, fellas, I don't know how I'm going to tell you this, but I don't think you boys are going to make it in this business. Now, don't get me wrong, your music is beautiful, but it's too educated. The kids don't dig this kind of stuff anymore. It's yesterday's show business, too legitimate. Besides, you guys are putting me to sleep. Don't you have something, you know, like a little more lively?" Well, that sure perked Howie up, who excitedly whispered to Neil, "Hey, Neil, play her the rock and roll song we just gave to the Shepherd Sisters." Neil was horrified. He couldn't contain his whispering. "What are you, crazy, Howie? Not that song. She's a classy singer. She'll be insulted." But Howie persisted. "Look, Neil, what have we got to lose? She hates everything we wrote, doesn't she? Play it already." So Neil did. It went something like this.
Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy.
4 lines of that song was all I had to hear before I started jumping up and down and shouting, "Wow, now you're talking, fellas. You guys got my next record. Stupid Cupid, what a title. What a smash.
Set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me."
Oh, I'm in love, Cousins. I must confess, I've always had a thing for Connie Francis, but I never had a chance. Now the record company publicity departments are always teaming her up with one guy or another. It was a situation that Connie and her songwriters turned into another hit.
Set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me.
On March 30th, 1959, Howie Greenfield, Neil Sedaka, and I were discussing material for my next session. As usual, Howie was sprawled lazily on my living room floor. Got any ideas, Conchetta, he asked. Sure do, I chirped. A name. I need a song with a name for a title. Names are always monster hits. Names of towns, states, people. The list is endless. Just take a look at these charts. There's Paul Anka's Diana, The Battle of New Orleans, Canadian Sunset, Maybelline, Eddie My Love, The Everly's Wake Up Little Susie. Howie sprang to his feet and exclaimed, I'm reading you loud and clear, Conchetta. But I kept going on with my list. There's Good Golly Miss Molly, Mr. Lee, I got a zillion of them, Peggy Sue. Finally, Howie stopped me with a question. All right, already, you want a ballad or an up-tempo? Then I had to break the sad news to Howie and Neil that I already had the A-side picked out, an up-tempo bubblegum thing with a surefire hit title called Lipstick on Your Collar. And no one was going to change my mind about that one. So, fellas, the flip side's got to be a real dreamy ballad. The kids can slow dance, too, at parties and hops. It's always so groovy if you have the right 45s. Howie narrowed it down still further. You want it happy or sad? Howie, I said impatiently, how can you even ask such a dumb question? Women love to cry. You should know that by now, especially teenage women. You feel pain much more when you're young. Make it a sad song with a simple name like Johnny. Then Neil got into the act. She's just saying Johnny, he teased. We know who she really wants to sing about. So we'll just call it Bobby, that's all. And we'll leave out the Darren part, because that would be too obvious. You know, you're real cute, Neil. But thank God, I got over Bobby a long time ago. It was just puppy love anyway, I lied, unconvincingly. But the fan magazines are still having a picnic. I can't pass a newsstand without reading some heart-wrenching story about how I'm home all alone slitting my wrists while Bobby's having a party with every movie star in the universe. And I'm talking about sophisticated, sexy female types like Peggy Lee. But me? I couldn't care less. See, like this one. This is what I mean. Get a load of this one, Howie. Even you'd have a hard time coming up with lyrics as tragic as these, Howie. Quote, Connie and Bobby are the reigning king and queen of the pop music world, but they do not share the same throne. So Connie has nothing but her music now, her one reason to live, unquote. Talk about a major drag. So Neil, forget Bobby, that's out. Let's think of another name. I flipped through the pages of the fan magazine in front of me, and it didn't take me long to come up with a winner. Wait a second. Of course, Frankie! Who else? Frankie Avalon's the biggest teenage idol in the country. The girls will flip over it. But Connella, Neil chimed in. Fabian is just as big. I set him straight fast. Neil, just how many Jewish and Italian girls in Brooklyn have boyfriends named Fabian? Come on, you guys, get with it. It's got to be Frankie. Okay by you, Howie? Neil, it was okay by them. So okay that I would soon enjoy my first double-sided million record seller. Roll it, please. Naturally, I introduced it on American Bandstand.
Frankie may have been the name of the tune, but Connie's true love was named Bobby. Connie will never forget that legendary entertainer.
Bobby Darin was my... But I knew, even back then, that every love song I'd ever sing would be my own private dedication to Bobby Darin, a man I would love until the day he died, and beyond that. I know it sounds corny, but to this day, hope springs eternal in my heart. No, not just the hope, but the full expectation, really, that somehow, somewhere, some way, Bobby and I will be able to love each other again. This time forever. Forever together.
The tears I cried for you.
It worked well. At the recording session, even before the end of the first take, I was certain that Everybody Somebody's Fool would become the best-selling single of my career. And I was right. Sometimes it just happens that way. It's a magical, indescribable experience. Besides, I had big plans for this song. Global plans. I told everybody I met in the music business that I was going to record this new single and every 45 after it in 6 different languages. Everyone reacted with the same enthusiasm. They shrugged. But I was determined to make it happen, and for a good reason. Ever since I was a young child, it was always my dream to make friends for our country through American music by singing to people in their own language. And everybody, somebody's fool, made that dream come true.